Hello everybody, I am starting to translate into English the videos for my French channel. The translations will be numbered as their French versions with a plus at the end. Today's video is entitled Gravity and its Mysteries. I don't know if it is still the case today, but for children of my generation, the discovery of magnets was always a source of wonder. And after going through a full lifetime, you are pretty much at the same point, even if you've become a scientist. Reducing the wonderful power of permanent magnets to a property of particles is not really such a satisfactory explanation. Magnetism remains, beyond equations, somewhat magical. As for gravity on Earth, apparently, no mystery. We are born with it, and the phenomenon seems so natural that it is easy to puzzle our children by telling them that people in the southern hemisphere are walking upside down. Up and down are, until we learn that the Earth is roughly spherical, very strongly associated in our minds to the notion of gravity. In fact, sphericity of the Earth constitutes, for many persons, the first Copernican revolution, and it is difficult to completely get rid of the paradoxical image of people walking upside down. This introduction allows us to measure to which extent the idea of universal gravitation, conceived by Robert Hooke, partly in analogy with optics according to Wikipedia, and formalized mathematically by Isaac Newton in a masterful synthesis, may have appeared revolutionary. The simple fact of replacing the vertical arrow of the Earth's gravitation with a vector of arbitrary orientation emanating from objects located anywhere in space constitutes a major change compared to the childish perceptions which shaped our conception of the world. For at least two centuries, the impact of this idea on our daily lives was negligible, and it was not before the era of space exploration and artificial satellites that we saw its applications. Today, Newton's theory is used daily without asking too much about its deep meaning, and finally, it is not more obvious than the cause of magnetism. In particular, the origin of the force of gravity and the source of its energy remain unknown even today. Newton seems to have estimated that this problem was out of reach for the science of his time, and he limited himself to developing the consequences of his formula, which finally made it possible to understand the trajectories of celestial bodies and to make astronomical predictions of great accuracy, until certain deviations from the predictions produced the emergence of relativistic mechanics. The general relativity theory of Albert Einstein provides a nice geometrical framework to describe the gravitational field, but unfortunately does not answer the question of its origin. René Descartes, who was interested, among other things, in celestial mechanics, refused to believe in the existence of forces acting at a distance without an intermediary transmission medium. His influence was so strong that Newton's theory was accepted in France only after a long time. There are at least two ways to understand gravity for those who agree with the point of view of Descartes. Point 1. First hypothesis. some elastic links between bodies. It seems that this hypothesis was not done at the time when the question of the origin of gravity was seriously asked, due to lack of knowledge about the nature of matter and its origin. We can, within the framework of our current theories, imagine that elementary particles are just concentrations of energy. At the time of the Big Bang, the initial energetic singularity would have been split into photons which remained linked together by some kinds of elastic filaments. These filaments would be distended first during the inflation phase, then during the slower expansion phase, but there would remain some elastic links between all the current particles, which could explain both gravity and the phenomenon of quantum entanglement. This may be a little too simplistic to be true, and above all, it is difficult to imagine the relationship between elastic links and Newton's formula, because the distance here should increase the restoring force instead of reducing it. That said, Newton's inverse square formula is true for extended objects and has probably not been verified for individual particles. Point 2. Second hypothesis, the Lesage theory. Here it is assumed that the force of attraction between two massive objects is the consequence of repulsive forces which push them towards each other. Let's quote Wikipedia. It is about a kinetic theory of gravitation proposed initially by Nicolas Fatio de Dullier in 1690, then later by Georges-Louis Lesage in 1748. It is proposed there that tiny invisible particles, that Lesage called ultramundane corpuscles, literally from another world, would impact material objects coming from all directions. According to this model, two material bodies partially shield each other from incident corpuscles, resulting in a net imbalance in the pressure exerted by the impacts of corpuscles on the bodies, and that tends to bring the two bodies closer together. This mechanical explanation of gravitation was never greatly admitted, even if some physicists went on thinking about it until the early 20th century, which by which time it was generally considered to have been definitely discredited. In the case of an isolated body in empty space, the corpuscles coming in from all directions have no overall effect on the position of the object, the only effect being a pressure which is not felt. Perhaps the authors of the theory saw there an explanation of the stability of matter. To explain gravity and the intervention of the total mass of objects in Newton's formula, Fatio de Dullier and Lesage had to imagine that matter itself is composed of corpuscles separated by huge empty spaces like the stars in the universe. They, therefore, had to anticipate on the atomistic theory and the smallness of the nuclei of atoms. The electrons do not appear in their model. The law in 1 over d square is explained quite well in this modeling by the fact that the solid angle under which we see the object from a distant point varies precisely as the inverse of the square of the distance. It is inside this angle that the incoming particles can be eclipsed by the object, provoking on any atom located at the distant point a thrust toward the object resulting from the imbalance so produced. Point 3. A remark. Newton's law, as it is formulated, applies to point objects having nevertheless a mass. In practice, it works very well for celestial bodies. From a rigorous point of view, it is approximate because a point has no mass in the real world. On the other hand, the law in 1 over d squared can only be understood for a three-dimensional object. Because if it were flat, the argument of the solid angle is no longer valid. In this case, the force of attraction exerted on another object contained in the same plane could be very different, and this might give an alternative explanation of some gravitational mysteries concerning distance and very extended objects, which led to the formulation of the dark matter hypothesis. We will come back to this in a forthcoming video.